Okay, welcome back to chapter 4 of the book from Professor Arkin, Behavior-Based Robotics. And today we are covering the architecture. So, what we want to learn today is what are the characteristics of robot architectures, what are the requirements that you had to know in advance for to design. Look on two major examples of architecture design principles, that's the subsumption and the schema-based systems, and also show that there are alternatives, but we will see that those two are the main two, and we discuss some of the challenges and principles that you can learn from all those architectures. Okay, but we will start with a simple principle. What's an architecture? So, an architecture provides a principled way of organizing a control system. In addition to providing structure, it imposes constraints on the way that control problems can be solved. And what you see is the key words here is the principled way and the constraints. And what you do is, in principle, you limit yourself, but it helps that those constraints, because you will recognize the structure. Currently, buildings, you always know that there is an entrance and hallway, so you directly understand how a building works, and that's precisely what you want to do also for a robot control system. So you restrict yourself, but to make your code more reusable for others. So that's the definition of architecture seen for a robot architect. For most other people, it's just about the design of a building. Here's an example of what they thought that the other university in Amsterdam would look like, the main square between the buildings. You see people discussing, sitting on banks under the trees. And what you see is what finally was the main square, just a parking lot where it was completely packed with cars. Now you see it's really old cars, so they removed those cars, and currently you can again discuss on the main building. The message here is an architecture is an utopia, how space should be used. How you use it in practice could be completely different, but we will look into that later. So, you can build architectures for robot control in several ways. You have, for this book, one main dimension. That's how much you do that deliberative and how you do that reactive. So how more reactive, how more you get to the behavior-based approach. But we've seen in a previous chapter that behavior-based approach is a little bit more advanced than pure being reactive and can add also some deliberative elements. So it sits a little bit in the middle of the spectrum. And it's not only this book that precisely sees this. Also, in the other books, as for instance for Siegward, you see the main approaches coming back. This is a slide from Siegward where you can see on the left the control loop, but on the right you see that there are two different approaches to how to build an architecture to create such a loop. First, classical, where you do it step by step, or with what they call new AI, but we recognize that as behavior-based robotics. Parallel, where you do everything behavior-based. So it's not only here, but also in Siegward, where you see those two ends of the spectrum. And he zooms in, and precisely you see designs that you also have seen in the previous chapter. on first hand classical, that you process the data as it comes and try to build a world model from it, and based on a world model try to design what the best decision is made, deliberative approach, or what they call the new AI, that different behaviors all try to make sense, all come with a good suggestion, and on the end you have an arbiter that decides what suggestion is the best, and that's the control that goes to the robot. So, to understand something more about architectures of behavior-based robots, you also have to see how that hierarchical architectures look like. In principle, it's hierarchical in structure. You have different layers, and each layer in principle controls the lower layer, and you have communication between those layers. And what the control is that every high level provides sub-goals for the lower levels, where you have a task and you put it in the abstract way in subtasks, and each of the subtasks you hope that the lower level will execute. On the other hand, you have a flow of information from down to up, where you try to get every time a higher level or a representation of the data that's available, till on the top you have a symbolic representation of the world around you. What you also see that each of those layers have a different scope. On the lower level you only look to the neighborhood and the very recent time scale. If you zoom out, you look more around you, and you also look for a longer time scale. And typically, you have time steps of 10 to 100 times more longer time scales every level you go up. So you have the mother, say, of all hierarchical architectures. That is Albus' design of Nasrem, that he created for the NASA. In NASA, they want the full span of control, because if something goes wrong, they want to know who to blame and who should they go. And what is also true there, that in typically, if you have space robotics, you talk about missions that can easily last for several years. So you have to have a plan on that time scale, but you also have to have control on the milliseconds time scales where you fire your rockets. You don't want only when during launch, you want to have them running longer than that. So on the right, you see those columns. On the left side, the data goes up and you create world models. You store that in the middle in a sort of databases. You see also some errors between the databases, and you can make use of the world model on a certain level, ask questions to the model below you. And based on that, you have every time the task decomposition and every time a subtask is sent downwards on the lower level. So that's the classical way how to make a hierarchical deliberative architecture. There are also other examples of such a hierarchical control. You can also model it, not say in layers, but as a different layers of an onion, where in the inner part you have the low level control, in the outer part you have the high level control. Or you can also, on the right with Saradis, make examples which you really see quite often with a three-tier model. What you see is on the lower level there are all the details to actually talk to your sensors and your robot. on the higher level, you have the level that's responsible with talking to the human and where the goals are set. But both layers are quite, say, empty and very task dependent. And every structure that you need to really get the robot running is in the middle, where the translation from what you see to the goals and from the goals to what the robot actually can do is translated. So that's why I call that this sort of three-tier models McDonald's with architectures, because you have two simple breads on the top and the bottom, and all the goodies are in the middle, and every researcher puts some extra goodie in it to get its burger with it as tasty as possible. Okay, that said about the architectures of deliberative architectures. What is the main benefits if you create an architecture behavior based? Now, first, what's great about behavior based methods, and you should see that coming back in the architecture, is the situatedness. So you assume that the robot is surrounded by the real world, so you don't need the abstract representation. So it means that the whole middle layer of Albus with the databases of the world model is not needed. Embodiment. The robot has his body in the world and directly feels and can change the world. And the intelligence that you want to accomplish is not by really thinking for a long time really hard, but in the behavior that the robot shows while interacting with the environment. So what are related issues where you have to think about while creating such an architecture? First, you sometimes have to make decisions from in your task if you go left or right, and you need something to make the decision on. That can be a symbol if you deliberative, or it can be a sensor, but you need to ground your decision in some way to the reality. Otherwise, if you cannot sense it or decide it, then you should have to make a random choice. That's not always the best choice. Further, you can make an architecture, but every task is always in a certain environment. So it means that you have to tailor it to a certain niche and make sure that it's while living in that niche, that it can further specialize and further adapt so that it keeps going better and doesn't make the same mistakes over and over again. And on the end, what's great of an architecture, you put yourself on constraints so that you can reuse it, but it also means that the architecture really has to be scalable and can be reused in a lot of different settings. And that is not automatically in a correspondence with the previous part that you specialize for an ecological niche. So, there are a lot of behavior-based architectures. What do they have all in common? Is that you have a tight coupling between sensing and action. That means tight coupling. It's not always a direct coupling, but the link between sensing and action is clear. You can use symbolic representations, you can use a previous knowledge, otherwise you make the same mistakes on and on again. But part, as we've seen in the previous chapter, part of the knowledge is more in the network than in the nodes. So you make a limited use of those representations. And what you also see is that you describe what should be done in, say, in a sort of overall behavior, but you have also the task decomposition in building blocks of behaviors. And those building blocks are great because that's the building blocks that are really also attractive to reuse if you port one behavior from one robot in one niche to another niche. So, why then we, if that they have that much in common, we have distinctive several architectures for behavior-based robotics. Chapter 4 is full of them. We will highlight only a few of them. And they distinguish themselves in how the cranality of the decomposition. So, what are the building blocks? How big are they? What are the basics of the specification? Is it inspired by ethology? Is it inspired by the situationness? Is it really a bottom-up approach where you make better and better behavioral specifications all the time? How? What sort of language do you use to code your responses? If you have several suggestions about what you can do, how do you make a decision what actually is the command that can be executed, and how you support both the designer and the user, and how do you provide support about reusability.